know too much about Transsolar, but about sustainability. And let me show you first something about the reciprocity of design lens. And talking about one single building, or talking about a whole town or quarter, and some interaction has different possibilities of interaction, and it has different results. So it's just important to see where I am and in what scale do I have the ability to change something, to improve something. Yeah? So normally architects are just planning building structures, like a house here or a block structure. You are doing town planning? Yeah? No. No one does town planning? Does someone of you do town planning or city planning? No?
You well, yes. The students of the University of Alicante, they are also studying like urban planning as part of their subjects.
Okay, fine. So, you see, you have different scales. And in a scale like a city block here, you might talk about water storage, water conservation, or green and avoiding of overheating a city. While for a single block or a single building, you might optimize daylight, the interaction between facade outside and inside, and so on. So that's different. Let's start with building performance in that overview. That house is the house where my grandfather lived. Yeah? I think it's so important just to get into an idea of thinking about the building. Yeah? How is it used? Yesterday we walked around in Alicante and saw these small streets and old houses and people sitting in front of the houses. It's a way of using houses in a way of living which is interacting between building and people. And so these houses are very typical for my home, which is called Deutsche Weinstraße, which means wine street. That's very nice to have a region to live in where wine is produced. And that Frankish style houses have a wooden structure. So they are completely built of wood and connected, and then these parts between are filled with clay or straw or something like that. So that was the ancient form of constructing houses. And looking at materials, the wood has a very short transportation way. It's from 2 kilometers from the house, from the site. Everything that has been used to build up that house has not had a transport way longer than 10 kilometers. So that's something really very, very sustainable. Then, the next is how long is it used until you break it down? And you see it's built in 1730 and it's still in use nowadays. So the normal, typical building in Switzerland now has a life duration of 30 years. And I think it's not different in Germany. It might be not different here in Spain. So 30 years is normal lifetime. This one has had something like 300 years. So it's much more sustainable. As a child, which is some time ago, so more than 40 years, I was from time to time there, my grandfather's house, and one time I was there in winter time, overnight. And that was really funny because the sleeping rooms were the upper part. there was no heating. Simply no heating. And that is in Germany. Germany has 200 days of heating period. We have more than 50% of the year it's so cold that, you have to run a heating system. And there was no heating system, nothing, no oven, nothing. And it was really cold. And during my time, you had to cover with that, because it was really nearby freezing inside the house. And in the morning, he lit a fire in the kitchen to prepare coffee and something to eat. And in the evening, when he came from work, he was a farmer, he again lit a fire in the oven. That was the only heating in that house. So, talking about kilowatt hours of energy used per square meter here, you could just measure the amount of wood burned in the oven. And that might be 1 kilowatt hour or 2 per square meter in a year, that's it. So, that was really very sustainable. The wood burned there was grown in the wood of the village, and so you have something which just had no other possibility than to use the materials around and the available energy. It was restricted very much, but it was not comfortable. It was very cold, and not so very funny to live there. And my aunt started to build oil ovens in every room, and a bathtub with a heating, so you could put some wood inside and heat up for taking off. So it changed. So that example of really sustainable building changed. In 1970, like I told, the living room was heated on Sunday. I didn't tell you that. But it was a room closed the whole week, dark. On Sunday, they opened the windows and put on a fire. Kitchen stove, no heating, bedroom. And farmers worked done by horsepower. So the tractor was invented in that time, but my grandfather denied to use something electric or a machine. He had a horse, 2 cows, 4 pigs, and a lot of chicken. That was it. So I don't have to calculate the embedded gray energy per year. It's very, very small. Take together all the materials prefabricated or taken from some resources around the site. You just have perhaps horsepower to transport the wood from the wood to the site, the building site. And so it's no gray energy in there at all. And the primary energy consumption is so low, you just cannot count that. So, you could say, a house like that has low to zero environmental impact. But that changed. Now we have a central heating system. The house is very poor insulated. So most people think, oh yeah, we have some straw inside the wall, and that's doing something like insulation, heat insulation. It is not. It's just very, very bad. And so, if you heat it up to 20 degrees Celsius to feel comfortable, the walls are still in wintertime cold, like 12, 13 degrees Celsius. It's a bad thermal comfort. It has no insulation, it has no air tightness. When wind is blowing, and we have often in wintertime situations that wind is coming from Poland or from Russia, from the Arctic, and it's a very, very cold and strong wind. And it goes through every untightness. So you can feel wind blowing inside the house, nearby the windows and nearby some fittings. Okay, so now from that very, very low consumption house, it has changed to disaster. And the normal way is you have a law how how to calculate how much energy you're consuming. You have to do it in the EU regulation way. And then you get a really, really good number. It's just a disaster. I think if a newly built building in Germany would use something like 16 kilowatt hours per square meter a year of primary energy, that one now has a value of 250 to 300 or 400. So it's really very, very much. Much worse than a newly built building. So I have a second example, a Baroque palace in a small town near Kaiserslautern. You see, that's a nice thing. Baroque means symmetry and adopting these old-fashioned Greek elements and so on. And it has been converted from a palace to a research institute for forest research. Yeah? And the problem is they don't have enough space for office rooms, so they decided to build an annex. And even that house, no insulation, it's just natural stone, and in winter time you can heat and heat and heat, and it's just, you lose the energy, and you don't get it really warm inside, so it's a disaster. The annex being built besides, so here, if I look to that building, I'm standing at the Baroque Palace window, looking down to that building. It has 300 square meters of usable area, two stories, and the thing is, it is... Did you make a photo of all of this nice...
Not yet.
Not yet?
Should I?
I don't know. If, are you interested in it or not?
Yes.
You are. So let's just take that 3 seconds. You need light or is it like that? Small amount that the air can carry is sufficient for heating. idea was no, no heating system or heated like exhaust. So there's no floor heating, there's no radiators and so on. It's just a simple thing. It has less than 15 kilowatt hours per square meter and year heating energy. And it has less than 120 kilowatt hours per square meter a year primary energy. So that means insulation values below 0.15 watts per square meter Kelvin or 25 to 40 centimeters insulation. Because if you don't insulate that building well enough, then you're not able to just supply heat by air, and you need more heating, and you have thermal-glazed windows. That is U value around 0.7 watts per square meter. Okay. And you see, opposite to these words you wrote down, I need to talk about a U value of a fenestration system or of a wall to get something described that is really low consuming and is energy efficient and sustainable.
I have a question. Primary energy and which energy is the main concept?
Yeah.
Only without heat, like the energy that we have to make
In the passive house concept, no. Let's start with the EU regulations that tell you the energy consumption of a building consists of heating, cooling, ventilation, and lighting. Yeah? That's the four types of energy which have to be counted, yeah, in the planning of a building and afterwards in measuring and consumption. The passive house is mainly constructed for housing. And there you have more energy for washing dishes, for washing your clothes, for drying your clothes, for taking a shower, and so on, for TV, for radio, and all of that is included into that 120 kilowatt hours. So what is primary energy? Do you have an idea? Compared between heating energy and primary energy, is there a difference?
Yes, primary energy is all the energy that the house is made without the heating.
Now let's say you have a electric heating in the house and you need 500 kilowatt hours with that electric heating. Is that primary energy? Or heating energy, or is there a difference? energy as electricity. Primary energy of that, is it the same or not? Let's go a step back to the factory where they produce electricity, power station. You put in gas or coal or nuclear energy, I don't know what. Yeah? You produce steam, the steam turns a turbine and electricity is produced. To produce 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, you need 2.8 of primary energy. To have 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, you need 2.8 of gas. And that's primary energy. And then you have losses due to transportation. Yeah? So electricity is running along the cables, and then you lose 5%. Or if you're burning something in your own house, it has an effectiveness of 90%. 10% go through a chimney, so you need 110% of primary energy to heat your house. So the term primary energy is really very important because it describes what you really have to put in on a global scale. Produce the energy that is used in the house. That's a really important concept. Okay, it's passive house design. That means the roof has an insulation of 40 centimeters, yeah, which is not a problem in the roof, yeah, you don't see it, so it's easily installed. You have 30 centimeters of insulation in the walls. That means it's a wooden construction and the wooden parts are filled with insulation. Like at the old house of my grandfather, but much better. So they use insulation material to fill the gaps. And then, what else? It has something like 50% of window area on the south facade. That is pretty good for daylight use. They don't need any daylight most time. So light is switched off because daylight is really fine. And they have a... So the consumption of the house is very small. It's heated with a heat pump. A heat pump is a device that takes heat from outside, from the ground. Yeah? So the ground in winter time in Germany is like 5 degrees Celsius. The air outside is much colder, below zero, and the ground is warmer, so there is an energy inside. Yeah? And that energy is taken out. And now what do we do with 5 degrees Celsius? That's pretty cold, too cold for us. So the heat pump pumps it up to a higher temperature by using electric energy. But it's not the same like electric heating. Electric heating would use 100% of electricity for 100% of heat. The heat pump uses only 0.25 or 0.2 kilowatt hours of electricity for 1 kilowatt hour of heat. The rest is coming from Earth, soil, or from the surrounding air. Okay, there is a little room, somewhere at the north facade, integrated in the building. The room is 5 square meter large, and these 5 square meters are the technical room for that house. 5 square meters. Inside is a ventilation system with heat recovery and a heat pump. And when you go in, you feel like, why did they build such a large room? Yeah? It's not necessary to have 5 square meters. You could go down to 3 or 2.5. So that means a passive house is so low in consumption that you need a very small amount of technical support. The machines, the devices are quite very small. And so, in fact, 3 square meters, which is 1% of the whole area, is necessary for the technical support. And if you build a normal house, it's a factor of 5, like 15 or 20 square meters. And so that's a benefit for the user to have less consumption for technical systems. Okay, we still have energy consumed, like written here, the winter time, the heat exchanger for the air is not enough. Yeah, it is exchanged, but still the fresh air being heated up by the exhaust air still has only 12 degrees Celsius. So that's too cold to push it into the room. So you need some more heating. And that is 15 kilowatt hours per square meter here. That is done by the heat pump. And now the idea was, we want to have that energy back, so in the balance, we have these 300 square meters times 15 kilowatt hours, which is something like 4,500 kilowatt hours. And the PV roof here produces more energy throughout the year than is consumed in the building for lighting, for heating, for ventilation. So that is a example of an energy plus building. It produces more energy on the side than it uses. The pity is it doesn't do it at the same time. Yeah, so you need that heating energy in winter time. You produce electricity from PV roof in summertime. So one solution could be you have large storage to store the electric energy in summertime and save it for winter, and that is incredibly expensive. 12 is not sufficient. So that's 2, 4, 6. It's 18. Yeah? You need 18 units of primary energy, say oil or gas or nuclear power, to produce the energy to heat the building. So that's the air conditioner process. And so you see, if you want to save primary energy, that's a bad idea. So heating this electricity is a big push. Okay, now let's compare that to a heat pump process. Again, we have 8 units of heat we need to heat up our building. Is only 2. So that's a big improvement. 6 is still 6 units. But compared to the normal energy wasting system, we have cut down primary energy by 2/3. That's really a good thing. These 2 units are electricity, and they are put into the heat pump system. And then you have something which is really perfect. You produce renewable energy, and most of the heat energy is coming out of the ground. And that is a real sustainable and environmentally friendly system. It's very expensive. The heat pump is expensive. So just forget about that whole thing. Burn your energy, your primary energy, at on site. That's much better. But if we decide to change to that renewable energy, that is much better. Then you don't burn anything. But you have really clean energy provision. And that has to be the aim. The same is counting for cooling. Yeah? So that was a heating example. But with cooling, you couldn't do it that way again. The first point is to bring the houses down in consumption. Passive house is just a way to cut down the consumption. And as at the point where you have succeeded in cutting that down as much as is reasonable, economically is reasonable, then you can switch to a renewable energy system. And that would be my idea of sustainability. Okay, to show just some impressions of renewable energy consumption, it's like PV systems, you know, and Spain is not that bad on installing PV and really large amounts of renewable energy produced now. In Germany, we are working on putting that wind waters to the North Sea. Why? In the landscape, it's so difficult to place these things because people don't want to have it. They don't want to have oil, they don't want to have nuclear energy, they don't want to have wind waters, they don't want to have anything. But the law for infrastructure is like that. Anyone can take protests, and so it takes years and years and years, and in the end you might not be allowed to install something. So much easier is to go to the North Sea and to have a really very expensive way of foundation and so on, but you have not to struggle with all the people living around. And we have installed so much capacity in the North Sea now, but we have no cable to transport. That's actually the problem in Germany. We have old systems for transportation of electricity. They have not the capacity to bring the electricity from the North Sea around Hamburg to Munich, where it is needed, or Stuttgart. So the industrial center of Germany is the south nowadays. In former times, it was around Dortmund and the coal region, and the available renewable energy is in the north. You have not a strong connection in you know, a cable like that. And it has to be built, yeah? And that decision process from politics and so on is so slow, yeah? And they are talking about 10 years now to build up a new grid, yeah, but it is not done. And we need it because we have the primary energy produced renewable and we can transport it. So they have to cut down these things during daytime when it's windy because you don't know what to do with that energy. So it's wasted. There's another project in Norway. They have a quite good constellation of mountains where you can build a lake. Pump up water for storage reason and let it down again when you need it. So one solution we are following now is to produce the energy in northern Germany, to lead it through the North Sea. It's not so expensive, only 2 billion of euro to build it. And then to conduct it to Norway to pump up water, then you need it, you get it again. So you pay the Norway people money for pumping it up, for taking your energy, and you again pay money to Norway to get energy again. So they have double business, that's fantastic. Okay, but we even have examples of building integrated wind energy. That's something built in Chicago with Helmut Jahn. And it is a refugee building, so poor people from the street can sleep there. And on the top of the roof, there is a linear a wind rotating device. And so it does not have to be something which is in the landscape. It could be integrated or attached to the building, but frankly speaking, it's not, doesn't make sense. Where are the wind velocities lowest? Where you have water, because it's zero at the ball. And far away from a wall, the wind speed is much higher. So if you are nearby the roof of a building, the wind velocity is very, very low. So that is a much better solution than that. But you know, people who are investing money into renewable want to present that. And if you are owner of building and everyone can see the wind energy produced with own eyes, that's much funnier for the investor than to have a bit of that quote. And same for PV installed like on a farm. Yeah, no one cares about it. It's just a thing for investors. But if you integrate the PV production to your building scheme, it's quite a different feeling. Like I do something for nature. The interesting thing is looking to passive house design. We have these 15 kilowatt hours of heating energy, but we have more gains because we have internal gains. So you are switching on the radio, it's heating up, or as you know, I'm not using much energy at the moment, 200 watts, you are only at 100. Because you are sitting next and I have to perform. So each of us is a machine, yeah, which is producing energy and heat. Yeah. So we are just something like heat. What is it? Double? I don't know English, but forget about that. We have 15 people producing 1.5 kilowatt of heat at the moment. If we switch on the light, we have even more. The beamer is producing heat, and so on. So inside that office building, you have some internal gains. And furthermore, you have solar gains. And if you compare that, the internal gains and the solar gains produce more than the heating itself. So the real cost of PV is something like 15 kilowatt hours, and a part of that is covered by solar gains and internal gains. And the rest is done by the heating itself. So that means if you balance a building, you need to know how much solar energy is coming in. And now take into account that building here. You have a shading system which is not working. So it should be closed because the main reason it was built, Ivan told me, is because it was too bright inside. You couldn't see something when everything was open. So they installed these louvers. Now you can not open them except that one here. And so in winter time, if you would need the sun from outside to heat up, it wouldn't heat up because the louvers are closed. So as soon as you start passive solar design, you need a shading system for summertime, and the shading system then that can be removed in winter time. That's different to southern countries because here you have a summer home. It's getting too hot in summer, and winter is okay. You don't need to heat a lot. In Germany, we have summer problem in summertime, we have a winter problem in wintertime. So we need to care for solar gains coming into the building in wintertime. And that's quite similar. That is a south-oriented facade, and the sun is coming here, and the shading devices are just open in wintertime. So you get that solar gains you need to that part, that is loss and gain. If you have a higher price before, you do not have any solar gains, and then you couldn't achieve that goal of 50 kilowatt hours, you would need more heating energy. So a really very, very important step in passive design is to optimize solar gains. So since we are not planning for Germany in that course, I don't want to continue too much on that heating problem, but just to make you understand what sustainable buildings, how they are planned and how they work. Okay, and I will show that again in more detail. You see here, if you want to have passive solar that you can design for a facade, and you have obstructions, you need to find a solution. So that is the step between one building and its needs to a block structure where you have some buildings standing beneath and you have spaces between distances. And so then you get the problem. If I want to have passive house buildings, then I need something like solar gates. And the solutions shall really just cut the house into pieces and make the solar situation limited. Just something we have done together with BIG, so Gartner's group in Denmark. I talked to Eva about that in the morning. And don't know whether you know BIG. Do you know BIG?
Yes.
So, they don't care a lot about primary energy, about green buildings and so on. But when they are doing a competition where it is asked for, they like to have that green label Transsolar. But you see, with that example, they are not just saying Transsolar on the paper is enough. They go with us. Yeah? So we experiment with form of building. Then, you see, we cut down building shape. So that building here has no solar gains at all. And now it has. Yeah, so that is optimized and the volume is much lower now. Sure. And then you go on with that facade here. And in the end, you have a very strange shape. Yeah? And then you go on cutting all these other roofs, and then you have a solar optimized city structure. Looks a bit strange. And we made simulations to see how much energy is falling on the different facades in winter time. So the analysis of buildings and part of the city available solar gains in winter time is a really important part. It could be the opposite for cooling. It could be something like best shading throughout the summer period and optimization of PV gain area, for example. So we would use the same tools for 1,000 countries, like calculating how much energy could you have. And if you have a building here, you won't have solar energy for the next building in summertime. It's the same problem, but somewhat opposite. Okay, and then in a large scale, in a block scale of time, we would have something like heat effects. So that's a map of Berlin. And it shows the temperatures. So that is the center of Berlin, that's the former eastern part, that's the former west Berlin. Friedrichstraße must be here, and Brandenburger Tor. And I cannot read these numbers, it's too bad. And I can't read that because my eyes are too old. Okay. But it's something like 8 degrees difference. So here is 8 degrees Celsius warmer than in the part of town where you have more green, more water, that's not so constant. That heat island effect is really important because the outdoor comfort in a town is really bad when you're walking around here. That's something like I can't avoid, you know. And but you know, if you have a breeze like yesterday on the castle, that was not so bad. It was a nice feeling to have that wind and the feeling of exchange. Why? We are cooling with our skin by evaporation of sweat. And when the wind takes the sweat away, it can be renewed. So you feel it really, it's very, very comfortable to have wind in summertime. So we are talking about a temperature as it is. Like, you have building structures here, you have no parks, no green, no water, you have sealed surfaces, parking lots and all of that, and dark roofs. So it's really hot. Yeah? If you mix it up and you take some green roofs or white painted roofs, or some streets which have a gray asphalt instead of a dark one or black one, then you can improve the situation and the effect will not be that large. And the other thing is you have to care about wind flowing through the city. So the most prominent example in Germany is Frankfurt. Because Frankfurt was just a small town in former times, and Goethe lived there and walked around, and everything was nice. That they built up high-rise buildings in the early 70s. And they cut the wind coming from west. And now you have a very poor air exchange in the center of Frankfurt. That means it's getting much hotter than before. Just because they built up that large structure of high-rise buildings. And you have a very poor exchange, and that means a high concentration of pollution. And so that's too important in a city scale to talking about sustainability. Better outdoor comfort, better air quality, which means less people are dying sometimes. So normally when it's getting really, really hot, a lot of people die. And like some years ago in France. And they are getting less old because the pollution of the air is really bad. Okay, then if we have time tomorrow, I don't know, I hope so. I'll show you some details about the planning of master city. I think you have heard about that. Was the idea to plan a sustainable city from scratch. And we were allowed to do that job for 2 years together with foster architects. And that was interesting. The result is good, yeah, no doubt. If you look to master city now, there's something like university here. Yeah? And even that university buildings are not sustainable, also very much sustainable as planned. Yeah? And the rest is not built, and so it was a nice dream of a sustainable city. But we learned a lot. Yeah? And it was so exciting to work on a project of that scale. 2.5 square kilometers. And being zero CO2 emission, zero waste, zero water consumption, zero anything. So a self-consistent city which does not anything from outside, no energy, no food, nothing. And that was really a wonderful thing to think about. What do you need to build as infrastructure to provide that? And you were totally free. We looked into building size, into distance between houses. So a town planner would say, a distance between houses? Yeah, you have cars running, and so you know, 7.5 meters here, 7.5 here, and additional 2 for that and that. And then you have distance. Yeah? But there's no traffic in that town. Yeah? No car driving, no lorry driving, nothing. Only people walking or driving bicycle. And that enabled us to say, now let's think about the optimal distance between houses. So if you have a very small distance, it's protected from sun, but you have no daylight in the lower floors. If it's a large distance, you have plenty of daylight, but it's getting too hot. So you see, there is an optimum. Less cooling if it's narrow, or, I don't know, perhaps more electric light in the hotter, I don't know. So that's what we did. We made simulations about all that. And it's like Dubai and Master. In Dubai, we have large distance, large glass house places. And so the measured ground surface temperature of 57 degrees Celsius. You shouldn't go to that town with bare feet. You burn your feet, that's much better. And the radiant temperature is 52. So you will feel something like between 52 and 57. Perhaps 53 is what you feel there. Much too hot. And in Master, where we rely on the optimization of distance between the houses, it's like a surface temperature of 33 and a radiant temperature of 37. And in the end, you feel something like 35. As 50, you normally feel a operable temperature or perceived temperature, which is a mixture between air and surface. And so, in that context, you are cutting down temperature around 20 degrees Celsius, just with a different density of the city. And here they have a road running through Dubai with 14 lanes, some in that direction, some in that, and space for pedestrians and so on. So it's really huge. And then you have that high temperature. Here you have only pedestrians, and then you can optimize it to quite different temperature. It's still not very comfortable. I don't want to stay outside at 35 all day long. But you have that experience here, I think. 35 is something which is not so traumatic bad if you have some wind blowing. Okay, so that is the possibilities we had here. That was amazing. And we did studies like what is the air temperature, what is the perceived or felt temperature. In the desert, you feel 67. The city square, like Dubai, you feel like 71. Using chain device for that stretch lowers it to 47. Much better, but not better. If you use vegetation to solve the problem, you get something like shading system, 48, 47. Same effect for a shading device or trees. If you use a narrower streak like that, it's not say that on 71, it's 67, much better. If you build an archive type situation, you get something like 50. And shading that does not help because it is shading. And in the end, our solution, final solution, was a shading at daytime and removing the shading at nighttime to allow for a cooling of the street at nighttime. And then you go down to 35. So you see, that's the way of working. We are trying to solve problems, not with a single house, but with a black box. That box is called street. Yeah? And the street is narrow or small. And then we have some additional devices like a shading system or removing the system, making it operable, and then you get results out of the system. And in the end, I cannot say that is Hussein Street number 50 to 100. It's just a model of a street, And what we have as consultants in the end is a handbook advising the city planners what works best. How should be the shape of the houses, the distance of the house, the height of the houses, and so on. So that's perhaps the way we are thinking and working at Transsolar. Master has the need for services, right? You need transportation systems. And all transportation systems and infrastructure is integrated into the ground. You see here different levels. So main infrastructure is one EU. And then you have a people mover system, you have a rapid train, so rapid transport, like underground, going to some places, yeah, connecting the street. Where is it? And you have something which is really personal. Small cabs for four people, and you get in and say, hello, I want to go to the hypermarket, and then it drives. And no driver, no taxi cab, it's just electronic. And so it knows the way and runs on it around. And it's driven by electricity, and the planning was up to now to have 2,500 of these cars, underground cars, I think 8 or something, just to show it is possible. So you see, the whole town is not really in the form or in the way of construction, but some of the necessary structures have been tested and proved to work. Okay, and to have only that underground traffic means the streets are free for walking, for pedestrians. The whole town is pedestrian centered. Yeah? So you can just stand in the street and talk, and it's a totally different feeling for people. And I think that would mean some of the words you wrote down in the morning. Okay, back to simulation. Yeah? How would I found out what is better? To have plenty of daylight and no need for artificial light, but a higher temperature. Yeah? Would I have to provide more cooling energy or less if I go narrower? And I don't know that for my stomach. I can say, yeah, 50 meters is good. Yeah? I have to find out. So we made simple structures to find out what is the optimal size of courtyard, for example. The courtyard provides daylight, enables you to have a leisure ventilation at times when it's useful, winter time there. And so we took buildings and found out how much peak load you have, yeah, for humidification of outside air, for cooling of outside air, for equipment, for lighting, artificial lighting, and so on. You see just numbers, but that's important because in the end we want to know if we construct a city like that, would have streets around which are 5 meters or 10 or 15 in extension. And there are different results for a hospital and a school and a flat. So that is the work behind, and you don't need to understand all the numbers, it's much too much. You know? But in the end, you can add up all of these different used buildings together and get a total electricity profile for the town. And from that point, you know, when people are coming home and switching on the oven to prepare meal and to wash, then they produce peak. Yeah? very sharp peak in the evening. And that's a problem, because when you have a system providing energy and it has to switch up and to produce that peak or to provide the peak load, then it's much more expensive.
Yeah.
If it would run like that, so here a little bit more and here the peak cut off, then it would be much better. So then you get from a block structure or building design to a power grid design, calculating storage devices, to cut the storage device that way and move it here. So that could be done, that electricity could be done in my time, stored until it is needed in the evening and so on. So you see, that is a really complicated thing, and it has several aspects like design of a smart grid. So when you're going home, you should not wash your clothes. You should do that at night time. And so intelligent machines which are trained to use electricity at 2 o'clock in the night would fit better than a thing where you come home and say, oh, I switch it on. And so that's something which is a research project now. In Germany, there are 3 different research projects. The whole towns are optimized to smart grids, to use the energy when it is produced. The more renewables you use, the more you need to adopt your need to the availability. So in Spain, that's really very simple, because you need cooling during daytime, you have solar energy during daytime, so that fits perfectly. But imagine you have wind energy, and I know you have installed some wind energy here. The wind must not flow at high noon. I think in the morning, in the evening, you have more wind in nearby the coast. And so the peak availability of electricity from wind will be in the morning, in the evening, or perhaps at night time, I don't know. Then a smart grid would say, hey, everyone who wants to wash or to dry clothing should do it now. And you could do that by phone and try to bridge the people and say, hey, you should have to switch that on. Or you have smart machines being overtaken by the power station. And that is a research project in Kaiserslautern, for example. And so they are testing how do people react on that, how is it working, where are the problems. Yeah? So in the near future, we have a redesign of power generation in everywhere in the world to make a better fit between availability and consumption. And that, the danger of a breakdown of power grids will be less harmful. Okay. Finally, I don't want to show you that because it's going too much in detail. I want to show you that tomorrow. And perhaps that last picture from Master City. And here you can see the smaller scientific city, which is the institutes of the university, and the cafeterias and so on, so everything which is infrastructure of the university. And then it is that Master City town where all the employees are living, and the top students are living. A lot of them are commuting, they are living in Abu Dhabi and coming by railway or rapid train to the university. And there will be a stop here, stop here, stop here, stop here, stop here. So that's a fast connection. And then you have from these stations the possibility to go underground with that 4-person cars to any point where you want to go to. And leisure and discos and everything you need for your personal life is located here. Should be. He's not. And then there is a bell of infrastructure where the plants are grown, need to produce food and so on, and bioreactors which transform shit into energy and all like that, what you need. Yes? And so all the flows of material into the town and out is produced or technically solved around the city. That means a lot of space. All the roofs of the city have PV to have that renewable energy. There's some more outside. Okay, and to show you that key solution to cut down temperature in the arcade pedestrian situation is a shading roof on top of the streets that is movable. During daytime it is closed and provides shade and produces electricity because these louvers are coated with photovoltaic modules. So you have a shading and energy producing device during daytime. At night time, they are turned in that direction to be as open as possible to the cold sky. So you are aware that in a desert region, it can be pretty cold at night time because all the infrared radiation from the hot surface is radiated into the outer space. It's gone. And if you switch the shading device like that, then you enable the infrared heat to go up, and you enable the hot air stored inside to go out. And then you have a cooling down of the whole large building mass during nighttime, and it is renewed for the next day. And then you have a good shading device. So that's the situation which is optimal for outdoor roofing. And the architect's idea of that was like having roofs on the building which are producing the energy, and that is just a fixed photovoltaic. And you have something like umbrellas covered with PV modules, which can be closed in nighttime and opened during daytime. And so I would like very much to see perhaps only an example of one square kilometer. Let's see what the future is. It's looking like that in the simulation. And I think, as well as we know that to build up a new town that is so difficult, yeah, to make it something you want to be, you feel well with the built surroundings. I think that combination of daylight and shading and trees and life is somewhat attractive. Okay, one thing we should talk about is materials, life cycle analysis. And you know we have materials which are good, yeah? So like wooden construction, lightweight wooden construction you see here should be the best. You can use perhaps, I don't know. Because why? Because wood is something growing and you cut it, you use it, and afterwards you burn it. Yeah? So the CO2 balance will be zero for the whole lifetime. But when I look to that, it's a heavy load. Yeah? So if you think about how much tons of construction you have here, it's clear it cannot just be done by wood. You need some fittings and things to put it together, and at points like here, the load is coming from here and going into that beam. So then you need steel. Yeah? You need a lot of steel, and you need a lot of screws and fittings and things. So the reality of that roof is not just being built from wood and being very, very green, but it is something built of wood and carbon and steel and so on. And then if you want to get a real answer, what is a better or the best construction in relation to environment, then you need to count that. You need to know how much mass you have and what material, and then below you are calculating everything together. Then you know if that has a lot of gray energy embedded or not so much. And so it's a bad thing, but it's not enough to say grass is green and wood is good. Yeah, we need to make a very, very sharp calculation for having comparison which is available to give an answer. And so materials with renewable construction materials, fantastic, but there the engineer part of the whole thing starts. Yeah. Calculating numbers, and no one likes that. I don't like to calculate them, but it's necessary. One example of less is more. That is the first majorly ventilated high-rise building in Germany. We invented that a long time ago. It's something like 18 years, I think, we started the line. It's near Neckarsulm, which is nearby Stuttgart. And we wanted to design a high-rise with operable windows. You cannot do that normally. At a high-rise building, you have strong wind, you open a window, and then your desk is really empty after this. So that's not possible. So we knew we need some wind shielding, and so the solution was a double facade. And you see here. So the double facade has some openings, so wind can come in here and go out here to remove the solar heat collected in the space between. We have shading devices in the part between the outer and inner facade, and that is heating up in summertime extremely. So we need a cross ventilation. And you can open windows, and then the client said, did you ever build a high-rise like that before? And we said, no, but it works. Yeah. And he said, I don't trust you so much. Yeah, because I want to have an example, a built example. And so we made something like a negotiation and said, okay, let's have the normal central system that you would plan for a normal high-rise building, and has the possibility to open the windows so you have it in the edge. And then it was built like that. And it works quite fine. Yeah? So when you have a room being heated up too much, and outside it has a nice temperature, you should open the window. Then there are motors opening the window. The problem we had is these motors were very slow. So when they start to open the window, it did like everyone got crazy. So what did people do inside? They went to the next supermarket, bought some screws, and fixed open room. motor made. So that was something we learned here. Yeah? You can invent a fantastic system that is providing natural ventilation, reacting on temperature and deciding what should be done now. But people don't want to be overruled. If you have something like that shelling device, and if it moves all the time, yeah, because sun is going around and perhaps the daylight on that point is going down, and then it would open, yeah, then people get crazy. They don't want to have that. And then they try to find ways to fix it. Yeah. So that is what we learned. Yeah? So at any project we are doing, we are working with daylight support, yeah, to cut down electric light consumption. And it's not a good idea to have a shaking device that is moving all the time. Yeah? No one can understand that. Yeah? You can do it in a quite fantastic way at the morning. Yeah? 5 o'clock, no one is working, you close it. And it's not important, no one is there. Yeah? Yeah? People come. And some of them have a feeling outside, it's very quiet and nice, and I cannot see out, so I open the shading device. And then, if it's going down after 5 minutes, they're getting really angry. So you shouldn't do that. So we have something like systems that switch at 5 o'clock in the morning, at 12. When people go for lunch, at 4 when there's a coffee break, and then in the evening at 6. So if someone has opened the whole thing in front of his office, it will be closed in the evening to have these 3 hours from 6 to 9 better shading approach. So that is what we learned. We learned to run a naturally ventilated building. And we knew we could do that better than here. And I think that's the next model or approach I should use. Yeah. That's a post tower at one. It's 170 meters high, I think. Built with Murphy Young. And that is a real double facade. Yeah? You see anaerobic engineers from Stuttgart. They're really fantastic structural engineers. Yeah? They made the double facade so slim. You have to think about wind forces in a height of 150 meters. It's like 100 kilometers per hour, or 150. Yeah? So that's a real pressure. And that pressure is taken by these thin needles. That's all. So it's really a very, very reduced double facade. But I have to admit, it's still a lot of material. So talking about gray energy of consumption of material, that double facade has a lot of weight, a lot of glass, a lot of steel, a lot of paint that is needed. It saves something. It saves ventilators, it saves energy to run the building and so on. So I don't know where the total balance of the building is, but it's a really smart solution, but it still uses a lot of material. And the latest thing we learned, which was taken into action last year, is the Unilever building in Hamburg, Danish architect. And Hamburg is something like seaside. It's windy, yeah, so I have view of wind all the time. And it's not so very hot, yeah? It's just a nice climate. In summer it can be hot some days, but not so very much. So most time of the year in Hamburg, you can open a window, yeah? And have natural ventilation. That means you don't need a forced ventilation system, mechanical ventilation. You just have windows to open. But when it is relief, you can't open the window. No, that's a problem. So when you have the chance to visit Hamburg and go around and look at architecture, you will find a lot of window solutions where you have a space in between, yeah, and some openings, so air's coming in and out, and you can open the window inside, and like, I don't know, custom fencer, or it's box windows. And the main problem is to solve a wind protection and a natural opening to ventilate. And now here we have again a double facade. But that double facade is not made of glass, but of a plastic foil. Yeah. And if you ever have seen a building with plastic foil, you know it's not easy. Yeah. Because it's like a little bit not flat. And then you see reflection from the sun or something else, just from sky light. And then it's disturbed. Yeah. No one likes that when it's just like a mirror which is damaged. And now there is some new material on the market which is lasting for something like 30 or 50 years. Not changing the color, not aging, not losing tension. And it's possible to make it real flat. So you have a plastic double facade. And that means much less weight. Yeah? And the structure taking loads is less. And so it's an enormous reduction of material used in that construction compared to the post-building bond. So I think here we have what we talked about at the beginning. We have an adaptation to local needs, to local weather situation, and local needs. In Hamburg, it's a nice climate and it's windy. So you have a certain solution for facades. And here, everyone can open a window, everyone has daylight coming in, so it's only lit at night time for show reason. Like a lot of buildings in Germany, everything transparent and everything saving energy during daytime and being lighted in nighttime was a show effect. But I have to admit, when you switch on that lighting at daytime, you need 500 lux at your workspace. In nighttime, it's just small lamps, it's not so much light you need to produce any effect. Okay, so it's always the really complicated thing to start with the weather condition, to think about what is appropriate, what could be done for renewable energies and so on, and to transform that to a material solution, to a constructive solution. And then in the end, you might find ways being really low material consuming and low cost producing. So that might be an example. So here you see that foil from the inside and look through. And it looks like architecture, I think. It's a bit strange. So when you walk around, you see it's not glazed. And it has some different behavior to reflect light. And to of the amount of light coming through, so it's an irritation. But I think it's worth to think about what could we do with new materials. And the industry is improving building materials all the time. That material was not available 5 years ago. And then there were new developments and better technology. So I think part of sustainable building is the technology and the improvement that industry can provide. And where does industry know from what should be provided from you, from the architects? So if you take the risk to go into a process where you're rethinking a facade, you're rethinking the building or the use of the building, then you say, I could do that if I had a device like, for example, the foil. And then talking to the right people in industry is the way to make new solutions. Okay, you will see tomorrow at the end of my presentations the DGNB rating system, because I told you some minutes ago you have to calculate and to count points and things being done good and bad. You have in the end a one number for a complicated process. It's like a system, not having two inputs, but having 1,500 inputs. But then you want to know, is it better than another solution? That's a rating system, like LEED or DGNB, where you can collect things that are good and you collect things that are bad. And so you get a high level of points or a lower level of points. Then you could say something is more sustainable than another approach. I don't want you to do that because I don't think it's much fun. But you should know how these rating systems work. And the last thing happening at the moment is that this evaluation or rating system process designed for one building is adopted to city planning, to town planning. And now we have a German rating system for the renovation of towns or the planning of new parts of town. And you have the possibility to rate the whole situation and to get platinum, gold, silver, or nothing related to some level of quality and measures you take. Okay, so that was a short introduction. I think I don't know what time you have. Let's see.
So we have a 30 minutes break. Okay.
Yeah, that's what you told me to end at 12, 8 minutes or so.